Happy evening. My name is C.A. Sri Lakshmi. I welcome all of you to the Standards on Internal Auditing webinar today. The speakers for today are Mr. C.A. Vijay Raja. He is a practicing chartered accountant from the last 15 years. He is a partner guru and Jana Chartered Accountants. He is a chartered accountant by profession, a company secretary, a cost and works accountant, a commerce graduate and a LLB. He has been associated with various professional institutions as a visiting faculty. Our another speaker for the day today is C.A. Guru Prasad. He is the founding partner of Guru and Jana Chartered Accountants. He is a commerce graduate and a LLB. He has also done his MBA from IIMB. And another speaker for today who is from the industry is Mr. Harish Moti. He is a chartered accountant, a company secretary and a CFA. He works with HP in internal audits team. And our CA Guru Prasad is one of the members of internal auditing standards board. Over to the speakers.
Thank you, Sri Lakshmi, for the kind words and kind introduction. Welcome all the members of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India and the rest of the colleagues who are watching this webinar. It's been quite exciting for us to come and present this to you, and it's also a pretty unique sort of a venture for us where we are speaking for the camera and not for the audience. So we really don't get back what is the actual audience feedback. Nevertheless, please keep pouring in your queries. Please send your questions. We'll try to answer as much as possible. Basically, why are we doing this seminar is a matter of interest. The Institute of Chartered Accountants of India has done enough accounting standards and the auditing standards. But at this juncture, when the Institute formed the Internal Audit Committee in 2004, there was no body which was regulating the internal audit standards, the process, the quality. The entire shift to the profession had a sort of a paradigm shift in this process. So the Internal Audit Standards Board made SIAs. Today we are going to discuss about 17 SIAs. Each of the SIAs, we will have to place it in this model where I would take up one of the SIAs. My name is Guru Prasad. And then we have Harish Moti, who is representing the industry. He is in the global internal audit team of HP. And he would give the industry perspective. And myself and my colleague Vijay Raja would give the perspective from the practicing firm of chartered accountants. As far as the auditing standards go, the process goes, how do we take it about? I'm sure all of you should be doing enough of internal audits. But where we actually look out is like a building block. When a kid is given a lot of building blocks, it keeps adding one above the other. And at one point of time, it realizes that the starting block had to be a bigger block. Then it can't undo the entire building. So the internal audit, something is like that. We already have progressed very far in the profession, but the building blocks of the entire internal audit is the SIAs, the standards of internal audits. The Institute has given 17 of them. We have a short presentation here. In the 2 hours, we should be covering around 17 standards. So approximately we will have anything between 7 to 8 minutes per standard. There are some standards which are small, we'll skip it fast. The other standards we'll deliberate. Can I request Sri Lakshmi to put on the PPT, please? The first of the SIA we would be looking out is the SIA 1. The SIA 1 would primarily deal with the planning objectives. What are the use of the internal audit? What are the factors which actually affect the planning process? The scope of the planning, the factors affecting the scope of internal audit and the planning process. This would be sort of the contents of the SIA 1. And objective of the planning, as you could visualize, it would be mostly from the suggesting improvement point of view or the governance mechanism. It's always said that prevention is much better than cure. An internal audit need not be just a prevention focus, it also can be a value addition process. It is a document which would define what is the control systems, what are the resources which are required for these control systems, what would be the audit team, what are the improvements we would be suggesting, and overall what would be the governance mechanism. And the next aspect of the internal audit would be what are the uses of this. As all of us are aware, internal audit is a part of today's lifeblood. It uses mostly for optimizing the resources. Resources are scarce today. We guys need to really, as chartered accountants, look out how do we benefit an industry or an entity to utilize itself properly. So it's all about control. It's not just a fault finding exercise. Now, if you look at the factors which would actually come from the internal audit, I think the presentation or the presentation or the PPT would always be in the institute website. You guys could always download the presentations. Most of the essays are generic sort of discussion. It would not be specific like a AS7 or the AS9 where we have to look at a position of law. So mostly internal audit would be a position of fact and how a fact can be perceived by an auditor. So what are the factors which affect an internal audit? In most circumstances, when we look at an audit practice, the internal audit plan is seldom fully aware. The audit team should be fully aware as what are the areas we are going to cover. What is the engagement exercise between us? What are the resources available? What are the teams in these resources? What would be the time constraint? Who would be the people who would be reporting to? So an entire audit planning exercise would be a large exercise. In most instances, a proper plan of internal audit would almost be half the audit done. You would have observed in many of your internal audit exercises, you would be concentrating on some aspect of audit. You might think, okay, fixed assets would be an area where we need to concentrate. And halfway through the audit, the senior audit manager would tell, why are you guys covering internal audit on fixed assets? You should have concentrated more on standard costing. Now, with a proper planning perspective, half of these issues would come down. And the time is always a restricted commodity. And especially internal audit is a department which would go when the unit is fully functioning. So you're going to an industry which is fully functioning, the finance guys are overloaded, the stores guys are overloaded, the machinery guys are overloaded, the planning guys are loaded, strategists are loaded, and at that time we need to move into internal audit, which would become very, very difficult. So when you look at a practical scenario, the management, the actual guys who are doing it, even though they have earnest interest to cooperate with the internal auditor, they really don't have the time, they don't have the bandwidth to cooperate. So a proper planning will ensure that these guys would definitely cooperate, and it's a dynamic environment. In a dynamic environment, the program keeps changing. We can't have a single plan all through for the 4 years of exercise. If there is a quarterly audit, after the first quarter, we need to sit down and revisit the plan, check out what am I going to cover in the second quarter, check out what would be covered in the entire 4 quarters. Can I go to the next slide, please? Now, when you come from the scope of planning and when you're looking at the scope of planning, the activities warranting special focus, we would need to understand what are the ground realities. Is it a client-specific requirement? It can't be like a Schedule 6 audit where every client we need to cover exactly the same. We can't just tell all clients you have to cover cash and bank balances. All clients you have to cover timing, deficit timing. All clients we can't cover deferred taxation. So it has to be a client-specific sort of an exercise. We need to understand what are the ground realities. Why does the management require an internal audit? For what reasons are they looking at internal audit? So in the scope of planning, we need to look at the knowledge, what is the regulatory framework, what are the effective internal control systems, identify the activities which require special attention. Suppose I am doing an audit of a garment factory. I would need to specially see that, okay, what is the labor constituency of this? What would be the raw material constituency of this? Those would be the critical items. If I am doing an internal audit of a software company, probably the manpower utilization, the timesheets would be some of the most critical activities. But if I am doing some other activity which is purely a machinery manufacturing company, or which is a lathe industry, or which is in heavy machine tools, timing may not be critical. Raw material might be a critical part. So we would need to identify what are the areas which actually warrant specific progress. And what would affect the scope of the internal audit would definitely be the terms of the engagement, the materiality, the experience of the skilled staff, and the management need for a specific area should not disturb audit quality and independence. Mostly in case we look at an internal audit, we are looking at a situation whereby most of the audit is driven from the engagement point of view. I agree the engagement would always be driven from the industry, the engagement would be driven from the entity. But what is more important for a professional is the professional would need to highlight to the management telling that, look, your engagement terms would give me 4 items, but I feel as a professional these 3 items need more concentration. The management would tell, okay, you concentrate only on the standard costing, only on the operational mechanics, only start looking at the resource management capability. But all of a sudden, as an internal auditor, I may feel, look, the control systems for purchases are not okay. Let me look at the AP cycle. Let me look at the AR cycle. The company is already in tremendous stress for cash. They're already having enough of cash liquidity at this point of time. So in an internal audit, we would need to definitely look at the engagement perspective. So these are the factors which would affect the engagement of the internal audit. Now, when you would look at the, can you go to the next slide? Now, what is a planning process? In a planning process, we would look at what is the knowledge of the business, what is an audit universe, concentrate on the audit program. Utility of audit is very important. It should not be a paper crunching exercise alone. What is an audit involved there? An audit is extremely vital for getting a result. What is the result which we are looking at? So the planning process would need to go into the result. Now, as an end result, if I am expecting extremely good quality control of an organization, extremely good stock control of an organization, I would need as an auditor what would be the universe I would select. So this is what we generally do in a planning exercise. So planning is quite a vital part of the entire internal audit focus. It's always said that half well planned, half the job is done. Most cases you complete the audit report and then the management tells, how come you didn't cover these three areas? How come you didn't cover these two areas? So it would be vital for us to place, this is the plan I'm going to cover. Have an annual calendar, have a split it into quarterly calendars. Tell the management what is it you are covering. It should not be a situation that you are trying to cover everything for the first quarter. Neither you are going to cover the full cake or you are going to cover the part of the cake properly. So you need to have a proper planning exercise. What is it you need to cover? Just would like to draw attention of Harish Moti as to what would the industry look at this perspective.
Thanks, Guru. Very good points actually that you had brought out as part of explaining the standard as such from a practice perspective. But looking from an industry's perspective, my thought process was more like it's better to have a global audit resource planning as such at the beginning of the audit or the beginning of the financial year, wherein there is a proactive exercise done by the top management of the internal audit, basically to identify what are the risk factors that they would like to cover for that particular year. There are different ways that they basically can identify the major areas of risk. The major one being having discussions with multiple stakeholders, be it the statutory auditors, be it business units, be it the enterprise risk management team, so be it the legal team, be it certain other financial information that might have an impact on the organization. So all these factors have to be basically considered in evaluating or in preparing the global audit plan for a particular year. Once the major plan is done and once at a high level the areas have been identified and a team has been allocated as such, the detailed scoping and planning phase might start. And at this point of time, what the respective team might have to do is to have a lot of discussions with different stakeholders, basically for that particular organization. Let us say we are speaking of Transurprising. So for Transurprising, we might have to have an input, say, from the statutory auditors, the Transurprising auditors, basically the guys who prepare the study report. And let us say we are also dealing with a multinational corporation. And then in such a case, what happens is we are required to get inputs from different controllership organizations and tax guys to basically to understand from their perspective what are the risks that they face basically on the Transurprising model that the company has. So all these factors might have to be considered, and the planning phase might get elongated for quite some time, but all these inputs play a very vital role in determining what are the risky areas that have to be considered as part of the audit. So going a little deeper on the risk aspect, so it might be very prudent and might be very efficient if we can sort of identify the critical areas and also try to evaluate the impact that that particular risk has on that organization. Now that can be done through a financial metric, through a reputational risk evaluation, different metrics are possible, and also it is important to identify the probability of occurrence of that particular risk in the organization. So what the organization might do as a best practice is, once the risks are identified based on the discussion with different stakeholders as such, be it the countries or controllership organization, the statutory auditors, or any other stakeholders who have an impact basically based on this particular aspect of which we are focusing on as part of the testing process is concerned, we can rate them into different areas, and accordingly we can focus our attention as far as the audit is concerned. So one other point that can be basically concerned is basically on the different risks that can be considered. one being the reputational risk, two being the operational risk, the financial risk, and also the strategic risk. So all these factors can be evaluated and accordingly can be considered as far as the planning phase is concerned. And the resource allocation, timings, scoping, everything has to be predetermined and accordingly has to be communicated. And there might be a training session as far as this particular area is concerned, so as to ensure that the auditees are able to, or the auditors are able to be knowledgeable enough to test that particular area. So over to you, Guru and Vijay Raja, for the next one. This is what I had on this particular standard.
Thanks, Harish. As you know, what we would do is, I will start explaining the background of each of the SIAs. Harish would give the industry perspective, and myself and Raja would try to give the perspective as an external focus auditor who is doing the internal audit. Over to Raja for the SIA 2.
Right, so we understood about standard on internal audit, which was about planning, which was SIA 1. Now let's look at SIA 2. This deals with basic principles governing the internal audit. So what are the basic principles that govern the internal audit? Like like Guru was telling us about giving importance to planning. Planning of course is the key. In fact, that is also one of the basic principles that governs an internal audit. Apart from that, what has to be looked at is, I think the first thing, it's like telling in cricket. In cricket, we always say that we need an umpire. And there was always a dispute saying that you should not have an umpire belong to one particular country so that there will be a bias. So we said, okay, let's go for neutral umpires. I think internal audit also has the basic principle that there should be integrity, objectivity and independence of the internal auditor. And of course, he has to maintain confidentiality. When you talk about maintaining confidentiality, what do we mean by maintaining confidentiality? We are looking at the internal auditor being acting like a doctor. Like how when we go to a doctor, we expect him not to disclose as to what problems the patient has to somebody else. We're talking about the same issues happening even in case of audit also. So if you look at the slide there, the slide tells us saying that integrity, objectivity and independence is required, confidentiality, due professional care, work performed, planning, evidence, internal control and risk management systems and reporting. Now let's understand all of them in detail. Let's start with one by one. Let's start with the first one. That's about integrity, objectivity and independence. Integrity, I think, is the most important aspect or the foundation of any internal audit that is being done today in any business world. If there is no impartial attitude of the audit, then the entire objective of audit fails. I'm sure in the industry also the same issue is happening today. Confidentiality, as I've already told you, we're talking about ensuring that the data what we get, because as an auditor, the access to data is very huge, and therefore we need to ensure the utmost confidentiality is maintained about the work that is being done. Assessment of risk is the due professional care that we are looking at. Any audit that we do, there's always an issue of cost benefit analysis. What is this cost benefit analysis here? Management will always look at, is it worth doing the audit, or should we take up this audit at this cost? Or the other way around, what analysis I find out in the audit, the ultimate outcome of the audit is what? After everything is done, if I say that finally the output is that we found out there is some kind of a variance in petty cash of 500 rupees, is it worth doing an audit at all? So talking about cost benefit analysis that happens in case of audit. That's about internal part of it. So I think regarding the industry perspective, you'll be in a better position to add a few more points on that.
Sure. So basically, one important aspect now that is really growing in the industry is basically on the OAP, basically the other assurance providers. So increasingly, companies have started relying on other assurance providers. And who are these other assurance providers? These are basically, now when we speak of auditing a particular entity, we sort of identify a particular person within that entity who can do the function of an audit basically for that particular entity on a continuous basis. So the role of internal auditor over here is not only to train them and identify the right person who will be able to act as another assurance provider, service assurance provider, but also to continuously evaluate the independence, considering that the person has been associated with that particular entity or that particular team for the past few years or for so many years. So there might be an issue of independence, a question of independence on such cases that the auditor might have to evaluate while taking into consideration the evaluation of the other assurance providers as far as the process is concerned. The second one is confidentiality of information, as Raja rightly said. It's a very important thing because auditors have a privy to have access to very confidential information, basically that has significant impact to the organization in case it is disclosed to the non-eligible people as such. So they are bound by a non-disclosure agreement as far as the information that they obtain as such. And one other incident that might happen practically is there might be an informal sort of relationship between the auditor and the auditee. Probably it might be love, probably it might be anything else too. But that is very important as far as the independence of the auditor is concerned, because there cannot be any sort of a relationship between the auditor and the auditee. Probably the auditor might have moved from the auditee's organization just a few months back. So there might still be a lot of links between the auditee's organization and the auditor. And so that might have an impact on the work he does and might definitely affect his independence and the quality of issues that he brings to the table. So this is what I feel might be very important from a practical perspective, basically from the industry perspective. So over to you, Guru, for the third one.
No, actually we are not in the third one. Raja has passed you on in the mid of SAA2. SAA2, Raja would cover a few more stuff, then we will go to the third one.
Right. Sure. Now in SAA2, we have not only looked at one aspect of it, there is one more aspect of SAA2, which talks about what is the work performed by others. If somebody else has done some work in relation to what we are trying to audit on, what should be the role that we should look at? What is the evidences that we can collect on these areas? And what should be the planning that should be done as one of the principles for doing the internal audit? And more importantly, ultimately, what is the objective of doing an internal audit? Is it just to identify a problem or also identify the solution? I think the ultimate objective of all these audits is not just to find out that there is a problem, but see whether we can find a solution for it. We should also look into the aspect that internal audit is not a fault-finding exercise. It should be an exercise to come out with some value addition to the organization. It should also be ensured that we are not trying to fight with the patient, you know, when we say a doctor. We are talking about trying to find out what solutions we can give to ensure that we can cure the disease. And that's how we should look at SIA2 as the principles that is involved in formulating an internal audit plan. Then we'll move on now to the SIA3.
As far as the SIA3 is concerned, we would be covering about the documentation. I'll talk for a couple of minutes and I'll take you through the PPT. Now, documentation is as important in the internal audit as much as the stat audit. Or if you're talking of a management audit, you're talking of any of the proprietary audits, documentation is our lifeblood. Now, documentation is not done only to cover our skin if something goes wrong, not with the intention that, oh gosh, tomorrow somebody is going to take me to the court, or probably the Institute Disciplinary Action Committee is going to rake me up and haul me up and tell, okay, what is it you have done, show me the documentation. Documentation is not done just as a protective exercise, but documentation is a directive exercise. So we need to understand why documentation is a directive exercise. Now, as an auditor, if you are just telling, okay, let me build up my files, file after file, go box file after box files, accumulate enough of information to show that tomorrow, if somebody catches me, I'm going to escape. That's not going to be documentation. That's not being professional at all. Having said that, that's also important. But why documentation is required is it gives a direction. Now, if you're doing a small audit of a $20 million company or a 500 to 100 crore company, it's a fairly different issue. But let's take an instant, you are doing an audit of an Indian Oil Corporation, or you are doing an audit of BPC, or you are doing an audit of a global Tata company, where there are around 400 branches, there may be 4,000 dealers. Now, documentation plays a vital role there. How do I document what I have done? How do I come into inferences from the documentation? Now, there are fabulous tools in documentation which are soft-driven, softwares are available, ERP systems and documentations have developed. There are processes in documentation which would assist us in giving. One example I could give is, suppose, just assume a situation, there is an internal auditor of a global chain which has got around 5,000 dealers across the country, maybe 400 regional offices, 300 sales offices. As the head of internal audit team, if I want to know what has happened to something as trivial as a petty cash, of something of a branch in Chitradurga or in a branch in Bilai, how would I know sitting in Delhi or Bangalore? A documentation is what would drive down. That does not mean as an internal auditor, I would sit with 400 box files, take the reports of all the 400 box files, culminate it into another report. By the time I do this, one financial year is gone. So documentation is a self-driven exercise which gives direction to state that, okay, there is a cash shortage in Chitradurga, there is a cash surplus in Bilai, something is going wrong in Agra. How do I get a single point picture of everything to make a management reporting or a reporting to the audit committee's documentation? So I'll take you through a few slides of documentation before I hand it over to Harish. Now, in a documentation process, we need to understand what are the human documents. If you see the last line, documents should actually speak for themselves. There is nothing that it's an audit file. People will go through a maze of working papers to arrive at the conclusions. The documentation should be self-derivative and it should be self-referenceable. And significant matters and what are the conclusions which we reach from these documentations have to be well documented. Terms and conditions of engagement, scope of work, reporting requirements, all the special conditions. I would go to that extent to tell what is the role of an audit assistant to the role of an audit committee has to be documented. Look at the factors which would affect the documents. The nature and extent of the audit procedures to be performed has to be examined. Risk of misstatement has to be documented. And finally, why do we do all this documentation? As I told you in the starting, it's a directive principle and not a protective principle. The directive principle will lead us to a place where how do I conclude based on these documents? An audit assistant has given 7 box files of purchase coaching. But what is the conclusion I do get out of this? What is the system lapse? What would be the lapse with reference to the business focus of the entity? What is the audit methodology we have used? So last but not the least, cover your skin is not the factor. Effectiveness is the factor. And what do we document? Generally, the engagement letter, the plan and the program. A hard copy documentation is extremely good. What I mean by a hard copy documentation is it can be a software, it can be just a Excel printout, it could be an audit program printout, but it has to be documented. It can't be just a oral communication drawn on a whiteboard telling that X you cover this area, Y you cover this area would not be audit documentation. What are the analytical procedures we are going to perform? Where are we using sampling checks? On what basis we are using sampling checks? What are the internal review reports? Are we going to have any questionnaires? What we define as a questionnaires is the auditor would go down to the auditee, speak to the manager, speak to the vice president, probably speak to the storekeepers, take down his feedbacks. What does he expect? Where is a lacuna in this? What is a checklist? A flowchart can be a fabulous process of documentation. Many a times when you are doing work, you would realize that just in a flowchart, you have already tracked where is the internal control weakness. Yeah, you have to back it up with proper audit exercise, audit trial and audit evidence. But a flowchart could throw out hundreds of things. A flowchart can vary from a small paper flowchart to something as complex as a flowchart which can come from the SAP systems or an ERP systems. Yeah, certification and representations produced by the management are a good part of documentation. But that would at least mean from a legal perspective, very important, more than the effective perspective. And result of risk and internal controls are important documentations. And we need to identify in the documentation who is the preparer and who is a reviewer. The difference between a preparer and reviewer has to be very crystallized in a documentation. A guy who has to perform the task would need to be reviewed. A reviewer is a guy who would actually act as a sort of a moral bridge between the preparer and the actual reportee, because he has to be like a filter which will pass through all the comments, understand the comments, assimilate the thought process, find out what the performer is doing, because generally the performer is a guy who is much lower in experience perspective when compared to the reviewer. And any cross-referencing to an internal audit documentation is very vital because of the size of the organizations today. Imagine something like a large petrochemical industry, or imagine something like a cement plant which would have a maze of paperwork. So cross-referencing and internal audit documentation is very vital, because when you grow in front of the audit committee, documentation is what which would save you when the people start asking questions. On what basis did you check this? What is the level of check? What is the level of materiality? Is there evidence beyond which what you are showing in the report? If these questions come, documentation is what would save us. And there would be exceptional circumstances. The details of circumstances with documentary evidences are required. Earlier, it used to be a PDF file, a Word file. today there are videos, today there are audio presentations, today data is captured through barcoding, data is captured through scanning mechanisms. You can name data, data can be in any form. And when and by whom the resulting changes of the audit documentation are made are very, very important. Documentation cannot be just made just 2 days before closing the audit. It's an enlivening force which will be there throughout the audit. The time you start the audit, you need to have documentation. Each of the documentary evidences and directive processes have to be added up as and when you take up the documentation. And finally, when you close the audit, audit documentation should be ready. It's a pretty wrong exercise when an auditor will start putting up all the audit documentation at the end of the audit. That would only be saving the skin approach, it would never give you a direction. And document retention and access is also very important. Access to third party cannot be allowed. Suppose an audit team has got 8 assistants, 2 chartered accountants, 1 cost accountant, 1 civil engineer and the audit manager. Except this team, nobody should have access to the third party. Whether it is email copying, whether it is soft copying, whether it is stored in your server, whether it is having access in the cloud computing solution, or as simple as a physical file in your cupboard. It can be a cloud computing solution in Amazon cloud, or it can be a simple box file in your cupboard. There should be access restrictions. And clear retention document should be there. This is as important as documents go through. I'll hand it over to Harish, who will talk a little about how important is auditing documentation from the industry perspective.
Thanks, Guru. So basically, we spoke about planning and the risk assessment process as such in identifying the different areas and also the test tips that have to be performed for those risks that have been identified to test whether the risks do exist in the organization and what are the controls that are in place. So now, moving on from there to the documentation perspective, this is where we are trying to put down the risk that we are tested, the control in place, where we are testing the effectiveness of the control that has already been in place or put in place by the management or the auditee. Then the next important aspect that might be documented for each of these controls is a short description of the narrative. As Guru rightly said, the most important thing is job done plus not documented is equal to job not done. Because after a few years, no one knows who did it, no one knows what has been done. So the importance of documentation can never be overemphasized. So once a brief description of the process is provided, it serves as a method of explanation about the process for a third person who basically does not know anything about the process. So for example, we are going to speak about the QAIP, the quality assurance process. So when a person is going to go through your documents to verify the quality assurance, so he needs to understand what is it that we are speaking about. So it's important for you to put down the important factors and narrative about the particular process. The context that we spoke to understand the process, we spoke to test the process as well. The next important thing that we can document as part of the procedures is the sampling methodology. So when we speak of sampling methodology, there's a particular SIA which covers the sampling methodology, SIA 5. But the important thing that has to be documented is the basis of determining the method of sampling, the sampling size, and any other factor that are used basically to determine sampling as such. Then the most important aspect is what are the test procedures that has been performed. So there is an audit program which decides what are the testing has to be done and whether we have done that or not. And based on that, the logical sequence is to analyze and document the results of those testing and the conclusion thereon. So there might be an issue over there which has to be documented. There might be no issues which again might be documented that there are no exceptions in the process. And relevant references about the process like manuals, your testing information, presentations about the process, all these have to be referenced along with the main document so that when a person goes through the document gets a complete end-to-end overview about the particular process as such. And last but not the least, the reviewer and the tester has to be mentioned in the document. So this would actually sort of complete the documentation for one particular control. And this has to be done for an audit for each of the controls the particular auditor tests. So this might be a good practice as such and would help in the preparing the evidence for auditors as such. So over to Vijay Raja for the next one.
Right. I was just thinking about a situation that we will plan everything. If we take from a student perspective, we always tell, you know, we have all been students for our, you know, for passing the exams or for every part of life. I was always thinking that we'll plan everything for our studies, we'll do everything that is possible, make the ground rules saying that this is how we should do, this is what to do, what not to do, how much time to spend and how much time to, you know, waste, and all that you do, your entire plan. Then we start documenting our entire timetable saying this is how we'll study, and after everything is over, we'll write the exams also, and the results are not announced. The whole process becomes a waste as to why did you do all this. Now that's why we always say after everything is done, we plan for an audit. We have found the what are the basic principles that we need to follow for doing an audit, what documentations are required for an audit, everything is done. Ultimately, if I don't report those matters, what is the point of doing an audit? So we have got first SIA which talks about planning, that's very good, we need to plan. We have got the second SIA which talks about the principles that governs internal audit, that's also very good, we have taken care of that. Then we talked about documentation that has to be done, fine, we have done the documentation, but then ultimately what is the objective? Objective is ultimately to send a report. We need to ultimately give a report to the auditee, to the management, saying that this is the findings of the entire audit exercise. So let's talk about SIA 4, which deals with reporting. Now when you talk about reporting, in fact it so happened, it seems, in one of the offices, one person was frantically searching for some paper. One office boy came and asked, sir, what are you searching for? The auditor said, no, I kept my audit report to be given to a company, I don't know, I'm not finding it. And that guy said, oh, I thought there was a working note or a rough sheet that you had kept it aside. He said, no, that was actually my audit report. Now, it audit report should look like an audit report. And how should you make a audit report? Let it look like an audit report. Let me take you through to SIA 4. Let us see the slides relating to SIA 4 dealing with reporting. What are the contents of reporting? Let's see, this SIA 4 deals with, it gives an introduction of a reporting, talks about basic elements of internal audit report, communication to management, limitations on scope, restrictions on usage and report circulation. Let's understand one by one. The first one. The first one is about introduction and basic elements. If you can see, it's very good for us to understand, we always have an issue, especially when we do an internal audit, let's say somebody is doing an audit for the first time, or to ensure that there's standardization of how audits are done. It will be good if all of us have a procedure that we can follow, that this is how we give our report, and this will be the broad outline in which our report shall be actually made. If you have a look at SIA 4, it is giving us the elements of an audit report, so it should be a title, there should be an addressee. We generally call this as reporting etiquette, as to what are all the points that should be in a report, and if we can make this as a standard indexing of our report, I think it will be good for all of us, because there is uniformity and the auditee will always appreciate that every report will be in this style. In fact, I always link this, the moment I see SIA 4 which talks about reporting etiquette, it reminds me of how we read a newspaper. Whenever we used to always look at a newspaper, we always knew the last page would be sports. We always knew that the first page would be the important information, page 1. And that way we need to understand that, you know, it's like reading a newspaper, which column, which page has cartoon columns, which page has the sports column, which one has the first one, which is the important news. It's like that, we have got this slide. We're talking about you need to have some etiquette of reporting, what to report and what not to report, what has to be given, where do you put what information. And even in reporting, since ultimately it should not be like a prescription how we write, you know, a prescription wherein ultimately I don't know what has been written by a doctor, and even the, you know, medical shop guy will ask me as to, I don't understand what was written, find out that this is the right medicine what he asked for. It's like that when you talk about reporting also, even in reporting we are talking about make a draft report and see what the draft says. If you have a look at the slide there, it says there should be a discussion draft, there should be an exit meeting, there should be formal draft, and ultimately there will be a final report, and that's how a reporting has to be done. And of course, this is like how we have advertisements. Advertisements always say that, you know, all these stunts are being performed by professionals. Do not try to imitate the same. I think the same lines we got here in our audit report also. The report must also say that report is meant for a particular purpose and it has the following limitations, or this report is intended for this management only and this cannot be taken as a general aspect of as to why the report was done. I think this is like a disclaimer wherein we say that what was the intention why this report was made. If we understand the intention of the report, that will be good for us. And if you see the last point where we are talking about it should be used for intended purpose and for the agreed purpose. The circulation of the report should be limited and it should be meant for to whom it was ultimately intended for. Before we move on to the next one, I would like to ask Harish to throw some light on reporting.
Sure. So basically, I mean, reporting, though we normally do not give a lot of importance to reporting, that is ultimately a deliverable. So, and especially in a global environment, reporting plays a very important role, especially because of the cultural differences. So every word that we mention in the report has to be meaning the right thing, because it should not be subject to any ambiguity, which might lead to complete different interpretation of the issue itself. So the wordings and communication in the report has to be very professional, clear, concise, and should be in a manner that the auditee can understand what is being communicated in the report. So this plays a very important role, and that should never be forgotten while doing the reporting exercise as far as the documentation of the reports are concerned. Then the next important aspect is the rating of the reports as such. So since we have different issues for a particular audit, so there are two ratings that are possible. The first one being the rating for a particular issue. So issues might be different different nature. One might not have a significant impact to the organization or might be a very small issue. So that needs to be rated or identified separately. And one might be very, very important and critical. So in that cases, we need to definitely highlight to the management that they're very critical issues and accordingly have to be rated. And there might be certain other cases where there is an issue, but the issue cannot be solved or resolved. So we might have noticed a risk, but we are not able to sort of identify a proper solution for that risk. So even those might have to be communicated to the management, say for example as a risk identified, but it's a small risk but does not mean something very significant to the organization, but might have to be monitored as such. So all these have to very clearly be specified in the audit report. And apart from these aspects, based on the issues that have been obtained during the audit as such, the audit report also have to be rated. So the rating is predominantly not to sort of find fault with the organization, but basically to say that what is the level of organization that needs to probably have attention for the particular area. So there are a lot of issues in the particular area in the top management, or even the board might have to have eye on the particular area and should monitor that particular aspect of the business very closely. But if it's not a major issue, all of the process sounds to be very clear, then probably the rating might be a little good for the organization, and even a lower level of the organization can solve those issues. So this is how probably the reporting can be taken care of in a global environment. So this is what I had for reporting as such. So over to you, Guru, for SIA5.
Thanks, Harish. I think we are almost say around 25% out. Apologize to some of the viewers. I believe in the earlier talks I had, my voice was low. I'll try to make it up back. In case it is not clear, please do ping us back. The technical support team would tell us what's wrong and we'll immediately rectify it. If any of you want to see more of PPT done, we have been concentrating on that. If you guys want to see, let's hear you talk, PPT is okay. Please put us your views. I would not like to have a situation where we do the audit and at the end of the audit, we forget something else. We should not do the presentation and at the end of the presentation, we feel, okay guys, we did cover this. So please ping us back. We'd be happy to address it. I'd like to talk about SIA5, which is generally talking about sampling. Even though we have a IAS, I think it is IAS 15, even though we have an audit standards for sampling, that would be totally different from the view of an internal audit. When we do a stat audit, that would be a totally different sampling exercise. The purpose is different. The concept of materiality is different. In so many cases, they don't even act as a it may be materiality would be totally different from a stat audit and an internal audit. Yeah, when it comes to a fraud perspective, even a 10 rupees is very, very big, whether it is stat or internal audit. But when we look at the disclosure aspects, when we look at the attention aspects, a simple thing as a security gate pass register may be very, very big in an internal audit, while it may not even place a view in the statutory audit perspective. So sampling would be totally different from both the ideas, even though we can base ourselves on IAS 15. I was just reading one of the books of called Blink, which was done by Malcolm Gladwell. And most of us in the profession, when we are reaching our second decade of profession or third decade of profession, sampling is something which is mostly forgotten. We tell, I know this audit too well, just concentrate on purchases of last 2 months. I know that's where it has gone wrong. I know this audit too well, don't bother about asset verification, I have been seeing this from 10 years. I think as internal auditors, that's where we fail. If you go on telling the same joke after joke after joke, first time people will laugh, second time people will laugh, third time they'll think I am a joker. So the same thing happens in an internal audit report. If I find the same mistake every year, revenue stamp is not affixed, stock variances are same as per every year, we are not even looking at the effect, we are only looking at the effect. So from an internal audit perspective, we should not go by the blink philosophy, being irrespective of the experience of the auditor, irrespective of the audit tools we have, irrespective of the size of the venture we are going to undertake. Sampling is a scientific exercise. We would need to definitely see what is the sampling. There are enough of sampling tools which can be as simple as a random number sampling in Excel, or it can be an intuitive sampling, or it can be a complex data analytics software which is available. Depending on the size of this company, depending on the complexities, processes, we would need to choose samples. I'll take you through the presentation just to run you through what all SIA 5 covers as far as sampling is concerned. Can you please direct it to the presentation? Excuse me, can you direct it there? So a sampling SIA almost includes the definitions, use of sampling in risk assessment procedures. As a matter of fact, the entire sampling is based on risk. The risk philosophy is what determines what is a sample. The simple logic goes that if the risk assessment shows that there is a larger risk in that particular area, the size of the sample would obviously become larger. So risk assessment would go hand in hand with sampling, so it would almost be like a predecessor cousin to the sampling exercise. We would need to design the sample, what would be the sample size, enough of approaches are available, statistical or non-statistical approaches, evaluation of sampling results, and it is important to also identify on what basis we are doing the sampling. For example, if you are doing audit of 2010, we would have adopted a different basis of sampling. 2009, different basis of sampling. When you come to 2012, we would really advise you don't go by the same basis of sampling. The entire thing can be totally different. Sampling has to be an innovative exercise. I hope you guys are able to see this particular slides. I'm sorry, the fonts are very small. The SIA defines what is an audit sample, what is an error, what is a population, what's a sampling risk, what is a sampling unit, and a tolerable error. Tolerable error is one of the probable factors which could come and address a subjectivity there. If you look at audit sampling, the error, the population, sampling size, unit and statistical, most are objective signs. It's almost like a physics or graphology. But tolerable error is something where only a subjectivity comes, and experience does count here. So it would be best if the entire team discusses together what would be a tolerable error of sampling. And use of sampling in risk assessment and testing of control is vital. Risk can be reduced by increasing the sample size for both the test of control and test of details. So if you really don't want any risk at all, you obviously will have to cover the entire 100% of the population, which can never be practical. If you are doing a small shop or if you are doing a small factory with only 3-4 equipment and a production unit which is quite simple and small, you can go down to the shop floor, sit down and see every single GRN. Just assume a situation, you are doing a Bharat Electronics or a Bharat Heavy Electronics or a Canara Bank or any of these large corporates. The sampling cannot be done in that basis. At the end of the day, audit has to be cost effective. The design of the sample size is important. Larger the sample size, lower the risk. Statistical and non-statistical approaches are very vital. When Harish comes into the process of explanation from the perspective of the industry, he would explain how important the probability theory is there, what is the professional judgment which we require. We can't just take a chance on our intuition. My professional intuition is very vital, but that cannot take a risk of an oddity. An oddity is extremely vital. We can't just take a professional intuition to be mistaken for a sampling professional judgment exercises. As an auditor, I would need to identify the difference between an intuition and a professional judgment. It is fantastic if the intuition and the professional judgment match together. In most instances, it might match. But there should be a document when you go to the SIA for documentation. Sampling is a vital part of documentation. And selection of the samples can be use of a SCAT. It can be a systematic selection. It can be a haphazard selection. And there are enough of tools available for sampling. There are softwares available today which would help you select the samples. It's not that simple exercise where we just go to Excel, build a random number table, use a small macro and run it around and give us a sample size. or it is not a simple exercise whereby I go to a software and just tell, please throw out all the vouchers in excess of 1 lakh rupees, and above 1 lakh rupees I'll sit and do the sample exercise. If I have to determine, I have to see any voucher beyond 1 lakh, that itself is a sampling exercise. Evaluate the sample results. In fact, we would advise that when you're looking at a sampling, stop in between, do a short exercise, tap the sample exercise, go back, see whether you are getting the actual results. And sampling documentation includes the relationship between the design sample and the specific audit, expected rate of error, assessment of sampling risks, what is the rationale, what is the technique you are using, what are the projection of errors found in the sample population. And the important aspect is reassessment of sampling risk where appropriate. During the course of audit, you feel this is not okay, I am getting more and more, for example, all of a sudden you choose, let me take a sampling exercise for the conversion ratios between in process A and process B. And in the conversion ratios, you select a sample and you find many more errors. Go back, revisit your sample. Are you sure you have picked up the right sample? If the conversion ratios out of 40, you are getting 20 errors, something is not okay. You need to go back and see your sampling size, sampling timing, whether there is a specific incident which is happening, is there a trial run happening, is there a quality control process there, or is a new employee come in and because of this there is an impact. So you need to revisit at that size. As far as sampling is concerned, it's a vital exercise. It would only protect you from covering everything. I would hand over to Harish to give his thoughts on sampling.
Okay. So, very good points. The main thing that I wanted to convey from the industry perspective is basically when you look at a MNC or when you look at a big corporation, the number of transactions that are basically entered into or recorded as far as the organization is concerned runs in millions, probably billions of transactions. So when we do an audit, we can by no chance or no means test all these transactions. So we have a particular method, we have to determine a particular method by which we sample, and that plays a very important role because we try to extrapolate the results of these particular testing these particular samples for the entire population as such. I know auditors are very happy extrapolating as such because it gives a very good feel and it really enhances the issue in hand. But there are certain techniques that can be basically used to really evaluate or to perform a sampling on a systematic and scientific basis. One of the techniques I thought I'll share with you is on the clustering technique. So when you have a huge population, say for example you are doing an audit on the accounts receivable process, so you can sort of identify certain attributes or characteristics in the particular population. Let us say you identify certain characteristics like days sales outstanding, then you can identify the credit limit for the particular customer, the importance of the customer to the organization. Many other factors can be considered as far as the credit rating that has been done for the particular organization, that we are dealing with. So all these factors can be considered, and then we can sort of identify certain population and buckets with certain common characteristics, and then from each of these buckets or each of these identified population, the subpopulation, we can pick up some samples on a systematic basis, and that would probably represent a much better way of sampling because we try to cover the population as a whole. There are certain probably areas that I would say that has to be given importance to, one being the way we take samples. We cannot take a sample for 1 month and then say we extrapolate it for the whole year. That doesn't make sense. We need to take a population that is the entire period that we are auditing as such. The second one is when we take, say for example, one particular entity or one particular factory, we identify certain issues. We cannot extrapolate that to all the factories or all the entities. So that's another thing that has to be given a lot of importance to. And third one that commonly people do is they identify 25 top transactions and they sample those transactions for the testing purposes, and then they extrapolate that result for the entire organization. That would not be the right thing to do as well because that is not the population, that does not represent the population in any manner. But nevertheless, the importance of sampling requires a lot of professional judgment in place, and that can come only with experience. So this is what I had from the industry perspective as far as sampling is concerned. So over to Vijay Raja on the next one.
Right. Before we move on to the next one, in fact, on sampling, I always remember whenever we talk of sampling, it reminds me of when we go for a blood test, they ask us, you know, you want to, when I go for a blood test, they say, come again, one before fasting, and then again they'll say, after you have your food. I say, why are you taking my blood? Blood is the same blood. You know, I think in audit also, sampling has got a similar, you know, connotation wherein we say that you cannot just say that you take one single sample, it remains the same all the time. So you need to understand that by period also, sampling keeps changing. Now, before I continue further, just to remind everybody that SIA that has been now what we are discussing here are not mandatory standards as of now. Currently, they are all recommendatory in nature. So since it's only recommendatory in nature, that's not the criteria what we are looking at. We know all standards will always start off as recommendatory in nature, and over a period of time, once it gets crystallized in a proper way, then we say it makes it mandatory. So these are all only a guideline for us, helping us to do an audit better, and therefore we all of us have the same system by which we can adopt and do the audit. We are done with SIA 5, we talked about sampling. Now let's move on to SIA 6. Now SIA 6, that is standard or internal audit 6, deals with analytical procedures. Now what are the analytical procedures, to what extent I should use these procedures, how much of analysis I need to do, depends upon what information I am trying to look at. Is it I am looking at the financial information, or are looking at the non-financial information? All the time we are so much concentrating on the financial informations that we may fail to look at the non-financial impact also. We say, is it hitting my profit and loss account, or is it making a difference to my asset and liability? Or I'm also looking at the non-financial information, which may sometimes have a relevance or an impact on whatever audit I'm doing. I think we need to look at both. Analytical procedures should be both based on financial informations, and it should also be based on non-financial. Let me take you through all the slides relating to SIA 6 now. Let's look at the slides on this. Let's look at the analytical procedures. If you look at the first one, basically SIA 6 talks about introduction, it talks about nature and process. Analytical processes are risk assessment procedures, as substantive procedures. It also talks about overall review at the end of the internal audit, extent of reliance on analytical procedures, investigating unusual items. Let's understand one by one a bit more in detail. Let's look at the first part. Now, analytical procedures, as I've already highlighted just now, it includes the consideration of comparisons of an entity's financial as well as non-financial informations. Now, in understanding as to what extent analytical procedures should be used, I think the extent will depend upon significance of the area being examined, adequacy of the system, availability and reliability, precision with which the results of analytical procedures can be predicted, and so on and so forth. Further, if we look at it further down, we realize that the analytical procedures as risk procedures would be, if you see whatever we have highlighted there, identifying areas of potential risk. I think how much procedures and what extent we should use the procedures depends upon the areas of potential risk that you are trying to identify. If you feel that it is not an area of much potential risk because the IC is good, that is the internal controls are good enough, then probably the procedures would be fairly lower in scale. But if you feel that the internal controls you feel is not very good enough, then you probably have to increase the procedures that you need to follow, and therefore it may turn out to be a substantive procedure itself. Continuing further there, the extent of reliance on procedures is based on the following factors, like materiality of the items involved. Materiality is always a subject of issue in all the audits. Internal audit procedures directed towards the same internal audit objectives. And the most important one is accuracy with which the expected results of analytical procedures can be predicted. What procedures I have used, will it give me the same result? The sample what we have taken, will it actually convey the entire nature of the entire organization? Similarly, the procedures which I follow, will it cover the entire requirement of finding out the actual objective of the audit? And last but not the least, about the investigating unusual items. If we feel that there is some item which is not usual, always an eye has to go towards an item which is unusual. And when you look at the unusual aspects, for an unusual aspect also, is the fluctuation significant or is it an insignificant fluctuation? And what are the relationships which in relation to what is significant and what is insignificant? Data that may deviate from predicted amounts. Ultimately, what we are trying to look at here is procedures that we follow depends upon, are you looking at financial information or are you looking at non-financial information? How much of risk are we trying to look at to be covered? How much of, what are the areas of internal control you can rely on? What is the materiality at which you want to analyze or look into these aspects? Let's understand what Harish has to say on these matters from the industry perspective.
Okay, so analytical procedures nowadays have played a very important role in the audit as such because of the sheer volume of transactions. No one can test anything, I mean everything completely as such. So analytical procedures have played an increasing amount of importance globally, and one of the methods that they have been using is called the continuous control monitoring, and whereby they identify, the auditor identifies certain areas and certain important indicators, both financially and non-financial indicators, and they try to monitor those indicators on a continuous consistent basis, let us say quarterly or half yearly, and those provide us a lot of inputs basically for concentrating during the time of a detailed audit for the particular area. Now Vijay Raja was mentioning very important aspect on certain exceptions in the process have to be noted or have to be looked upon. So one of the aspects, for example, I can give you an example. Now when you look at, say, the journal entries that have been recorded, you can look at terminated users basically passing entries. So that plays a very important role because those entries, there's a question whether the entries are genuine or whether they are fraudulent in nature, so things like that. So the importance has increased over a period of time, and a lot of companies have started implementing the continuous control monitoring for different areas, and the results of these particular tools that they use is now used in the audit as such and helps in sort of getting a high level understanding about the organization as well. So I can give you another example too. So when we speak of an analytical procedure, we can sort of, now let us say when we identify the credit process for a particular bank, we have a lot of banks that a company has accounts with, and we also evaluate the credit worthiness of the bank when we do an when we have funds with the bank as such. So how does the company sort of evaluate the credit worthiness on a continuous consistent basis? So we see a lot of bank failures. So one of the aspects that can be monitored is the credit default swap, which is available through public sources. So when there is an increase in the credit default swap, basically it means the riskiness of the particular bank is increasing, and the entity must proactively consider shifting funds to another bank. So this is how an analytical procedure can be used, and that can have an impact on the organization as well. So the auditor can use these procedures basically for identifying the risk as well as understanding on an overall basis whether the particular area is fine overall or there are risks basically in the process. So over to you, Guru, basically in the process.
Thanks, Harish. The questions are pouring in. Thank you so much, Mehta ji, Rajvanshi ji. We have got questions from Tamil Nadu, we have got questions from Jaipur, from Hyderabad. It's been doing well. Please pour it in. What we felt is most of the questions we'll try to park it in the end, because in this allotted 2 hours we need to cover the 17 essays. But rest assured, all the questions would be answered. In case we are not able to take it now, we'll put it under the FAQs and we would get answered of everything, from questions from profitability to questions to SAA to ISP. Most of it are there. I'd like to talk about SAA 7. Now, this is one of the nice SAAs which has actually happened. Firstly, let us understand internal audit is a quality feature. It is enhancing the quality in our organization, whether it is the quality of the finances or the processes or anything. Internal audit itself is quality. For that quality, we have an internal audit, and we have a quality assurances for the quality standards. And for these quality assurances, we have a standard which gives us what should be the quality. So I would confuse it by telling quality to quality to quality. So when we look at the internal audit for quality standards, it would be the same whether it is an in-house internal audit mechanism or an external professional firm of a chartered accountants, or there can be a corporate body of professionals who are doing audit. It need not be just a chartered accountancy firm, we may corporatize to our extent. From a quality assurance standpoint of view, we would need to understand that the most important aspect is the bias, because audit is a repetitive exercise. As much as stat audit where people go out in 3 days and new guys come in, internal audit very often can be a repetitive exercise. Fortunately, with the manpower turnover, if an organization that would be a high attrition rate, at least there would be some sort of people who are going in, new people coming in, so there may not be a bias. But if there is a situation where one gentleman or a team of four or five people are doing the same audit for a period of 2 years, 3 years, there would be a sort of reckoning thing happening, and that would lead to quality issues. So they would need to have some sort of a quality assurances process in this. Well, this is small standard, this is not a large standard. There are just three or four slides in this. I'll take you through the slides now. Excuse me, if you could take us through the slides, it will be helpful. We would concentrate on what is the introduction, the scope and objective of this in-house internal audit, and what would be a quality review here. If you look at internal audit per se, it itself is a critical appraisal of what is happening. Critical need not be always taken in a negative form. There would be a positive connotation also regarding criticality of it. And if you observe the word continuous, it is a continuous process. It's not like that, okay, I did the quarterly audit, I did the half yearly audit, there it goes, that's about it, there is no more internal audit. It's a continuous cycle as long as the company is a going concern. And it improves the systems and strengthens the systems. Some may wonder, what is there to improve for an organization? As we started telling you in the SIA 1, SIA 2, it's a dynamic process. What is there in quarter 1 need not be in quarter 2. The entire economics might change. The entire scales may change. The risk factors may change. So quality is something which would need to go back and see, what are we doing in internal audit, is it okay? It's a sort of a governance mechanism. What is the scope applicable whether in, wherever an internal audit or whenever an internal audit is carried on? Whether by internal audit department is an external or a professional firm of chartered accountants. Especially if it is an internal audit department, please don't for heaven's sake think that, okay, the guy, it was not those days where I didn't get a job anywhere, that's why I went and joined the internal audit department. It's not in today's world. Internal audit department is the forefront of the top management of the company. Internal audit department gives the direction. It's some sort of a Krishna who is riding the chariot for the company. It gives the direction for the entire company. And a quality assurance standard is very required to improve the functionalities of the organization and transparencies of reporting, so that grapevine is not built up, so that we don't develop relationships with a client, so that there is no bias in any of these aspects. Now, in an in-house internal audit department, leadership responsibility is extremely vital. There may be many companies where the top auditor would remain there for 4 years, 5 years. The challenge for him is to search new areas. The challenge for him is to search, looking at it in a different approach. In a way, he is almost like an artist. It's a creative job, it's not a humdrum job. So a leadership responsibility for quality of the internal audit is extremely high. It goes without saying, ethical requirement is above everything. And acceptance and continuity of relationship of the client need not be determining what is the focus of internal audit. It can't be said that, okay, if I point out these 7 points, I lose my internal audit assignment. That would never be a situation. So a quality check would always ensure whether I continue this relationship or no is secondary importance when compared to the fact that whether I am giving an unbiased approach. What are the human resources? Are we rotating the resources? Are the same guys doing the same job? The gentleman who is the team which is doing AP next year would do the AR. The team which is doing AR next year would do the GL. The team which is doing GL next year would do the risk assessment. So it has to be a process where everybody moves out on a rotation basis. And the engagement performance has to be seen. Are we going towards the engagement? Are we going in a totally different tandem? So monitoring often is quite required in an internal audit exercise. And it is a process of reviewing, one person reviewing the job of the another person. In a way, in many large organizations, quality would be a separate team inside the internal audit team. Suppose there are 400 auditors doing an audit of Unilever Group or Infosys, there would be an internal audit quality team which can be a separate part of it. That's as far as the SIA 7 is concerned regarding the internal audit. Harish.
So I thought I'll speak about a few best practices in the industry as such, which helps basically to improve the quality of work that we do on a consistent basis. The first one is to get a customer feedback. So basically the customer here are our auditees. So once our audit is completed, so we can write to them as a survey or as a mail or a note to them and ask them for their feedback, areas of improvement that they feel might have been better during the audit. And that takes the internal audit profession to a long way, as it helps in continuous growth of the profession and the quality of work that we do. The second good practice might be in terms of retrospective after the audit. So once an audit is completed, the audit team, the manager, and the respective heads of the particular team or they might sort of come together and discuss on what went good in the audit, what did not go good in the audit, what are the areas of improvement. And when we do this for each of the audits that we do, we definitely see a huge improvement in the process over a period of time. So these two add a lot of value to the organization in terms of continuous development of the profession as such. And nevertheless, it's important to mention that the quality has two aspects. One, project management as such, wherein we sort of on a continuous basis monitor the engagement, and second being the quality of work that we perform. So the quality of work also involves a lot of aspects, the knowledge of the auditor, the area of expertise and things like that. But these two factors have to be considered as far as quality is concerned. So over to you, Raja, on the next one.
Right. So just to quickly recap on what we are trying to understand right from the beginning. We started with planning. We went into the principles involved in internal audit. We talked about documentation. We talked about the reporting etiquettes to be taken care. We spoke on sampling that has to be taken care. What sample size you need to select. We understood about the quality assurance just now, analytical procedures. Let's move on further slightly more. Before I move on to the next SIA, it always reminds me of one aspect, you know, that is, it seems one person walks into a restaurant and he says, hey, I'm very hungry, give me something to eat. And immediately that guy says, okay, here it is, and he gives him fish. And the person says, I don't eat fish, I'm a vegetarian. What is the point of doing all the exercise, and that is not what I wanted? And I think we need to understand, when we walk into an audit also, a client will tell us, or the auditee will tell us, hey, I want to do an audit. Fine, you want to do an audit, we'll start off with an audit. Internal audit is done. And ultimately it tells, this is not the branch what I wanted you to do. I wanted you to focus on this area and not on this area at all. And therefore it's important to understand that we need to have an audit engagement letter. And we are talking about SIA 8, which talks about audit engagement letter. Let's understand the audit engagement letter. The whole concept of an audit engagement letter, SIA 8 says that there must be an understanding between the auditor and the auditee as to what is the scope of work that the auditee is looking at, what is it that he requires. You can't give him something which he does not ask for. I think you need to feed a person only when he is hungry. So you need to give him what he is asking for. You need to get that in writing. We need to ensure that we have it in writing. It has to be signed by both the parties. And ensure that this entire scope is equally and clearly distributed and in clear terms mentioned about it. And fine, once we have started the audit, suppose in the course of audit, in the internal audit scheme itself, we realize that probably we could have added something extra, or maybe I want to increase the scope of work, or maybe I want to reduce the scope of work. Can I do that? Yes, that again should be part of writing itself. So this is a small SIA that I am talking about, but I think it's a very important one, because everything should be in writing as to what is my role, what is it that is expected from the auditor, and what the auditee wants, which area of audit is he looking at. I may do an audit of X area, but he wants me to do an audit of Y area. Everything should be in very clear terms. Let's understand this particular SIA 8 and let's have a look at the slides relating to this. Let's move on to the slides now. Now, if you look at the terms of internal audit engagement, it starts with introduction, elements of terms of engagement, and withdrawal from engagement. As far as introduction is concerned, I need to agree on the terms of the engagement before commencement of audit itself. The agreed terms would need to be recorded in an engagement letter. The responsibility of internal auditor to prepare the engagement letter, ensure it is signed, ensure that whatever modifications are also there is also recorded. Then what do we have next? Then we are talking about elements of the terms of the engagement. You should talk about the scope, it should contain the responsibilities, authority, confidentiality, limitations, reporting, what shall be the compensation that will be paid, and compliance with standards. It is very important that the entire engagement letter is first prepared by the auditor himself, so he is aware as to what is required out of him. And then come to the last aspect of it. If there is any change in terms, I should decide as an auditor whether I should continue to do the audit, because the terms which they are talking about is, if it is not something which we can agree upon, then we should withdraw from the entire assignment itself and say that I will not take up this audit at all. That depends upon whether we are okay with the change in terms if the change in terms is about increasing the area, whether I'm capable of doing it, or if it decreases in area, which is going to affect my independence itself, needs to be looked at before I can think about it. Over to you, Harish, to do add on this.
Sure. So basically, one aspect at the time of the engagement letter itself is to identify what was the previous experience, basically in case we have done an audit in that area. The second aspect is communicating ahead to the management so that they are aware and allocate resources for us, because they have their own schedule. So we need to allocate some time, dedicate some resources to cater to our requirements as such. So the third important aspect is the what we communicate in the engagement letter. So we need to be very clear in communicating the timelines, the persons who will be involved in that audit, what are the areas that we're going to cover. So this is part of the planning exercise that we did. We did identify the areas that we are going to test. So that has to come out in the engagement letter and should be very clearly communicated to the management. The last important aspect that might be very significant is the distribution list. So whom are we addressing the engagement letter to? So who are the intended auditees or the people who are involved in the audit? It might be the auditor's organization, might be the auditee's organization, might be the finance organization. So but that has to be determined, and there has to be a process for identifying the auditees as well. So this is what I basically had on this particular standard. We move on to the next one.
Thanks, Harish. I'll be covering on SAA 9. It would be a simple standard. It's about communication, which is going to be the communication process for audit. But as simple the standard, as it is always said, being simple is very difficult, very complex. So communication is never going to be simple. Communication is not as just that, okay, I am going to write an audit report, put it on the desk of the client and walk it out. That is not going to be there. There are vital things with relates to 5 points. One would be, what is the timing of communication? There is an audit cycle of every quarter, and the auditor is finding out there is a small fraud or a big fraud in a particular aspect. Cash and bank balances are not stated properly. BRS is not done properly. He can't just wait at the end of the quarter to prepare the formal report and go it. He has to raise the red flag. There has to be fire pointed out soon. We can't engulf the fire in one quarter, probably the company can get eroded. When a small spark is seen and you know that there is a issue in that small spark, issue an addendum report, issue an interim report, at least shoot out an email. It's vital part of communication. And the second part of communication which could be important is, an auditor's job is not just to go and have an approach of, okay, I got this audit, I have to prove myself, I'm going to finish everybody who's going to be there. That's not going to be the exercise. You need to understand that, yes, we are a team working together, but we have our independence. Just because we have independence, that does not mean that I'm not going to talk to anybody. I'll just shoot out a letter to the audit committee. We would never get information. So it's one of the most important tactics what an auditor has to use. He has to be extremely diplomatic. See, we are professionals. We are guided by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. As a professional, we need to have professional qualities when we communicate. So communication is of vital importance. I'll just take you to two, three slides and just run through this as fast as possible. Now, what is the introduction? What are the matters to be communicated? What is the communication process? And what would be the documentation? This standard just provides a framework for communication. We should consider this framework. Most importantly, provide timely observations. Having an observation 4 months after the event doesn't really make any sense for the auditee. The auditee wants what is going wrong in the organization. Many a times when you finalize the balance sheet of March 2012 in the period of September 2012, the client would hardly not know the importance of a balance sheet after 6 months when he has already done operations in the current year. So raising a red flag is extremely important. Promote effective two-way communication. Let there be communication with the client. There is no hidden agenda between us. Having said that, yeah, you have found out something wrong, you are an audit junior, your manager has not seen it, the partner has not seen it, that doesn't mean the junior just walks into the cabin of a VP and tells there is something wrong in this place. Take time, understand with the issue, speak to everybody, have a discussion draft, have an exit meeting, have a formal draft, have a final report. Communication is extremely important. Even before starting the audit, there should be an opening meeting. Even at the end of the audit, there should be a closing meeting. Meetings are vital in a part of the audit. And establish a communication process. Keep advising the client, look, these are the issues, I'll formalize it in the report. Even if you drop out a point from the audit, there should be a communication channel. Yes, I saw this was, the point which I raised, and based on this point I came across with this answers. The answers are okay, but I felt it should be placed for a communication. Fabulous. Please good to do it properly. And oral communication is as important as a written communication. To put across an issue, the team lead or the manager would need to speak to the top management. A communication should not affect the apple cart of the running business. A communication should not break the relationships between people. Communication is one of the most tactful standards, and that's where it becomes an important part of the audit standards. Now Harish would give you a few instances how important is communication, especially in a global environment.
Right. So communication, again, the importance can never be stated in words, because that ultimately forms the bread and butter of audit. But still, I mean, there are certain best practices that can be included as part of the communication process. One being providing a management an opportunity to report issues that they have noticed in the process. Hey, you need to give credit basically to the aspects that the management has identified proactively and also is trying to resolve them. So this has an impact basically in the audit, because we may not focus our efforts and energy on something that has already been done. What we need to do is just understand what the issue is about, what are the steps taken by management, and give credit to them when we issue the audit report and include that in the evaluation on the reporting process as well. The second one that might be very important is communicating the audit process to the management. So they need to be aware of what is the process, the scoping process, how are we doing the entire process. We need not be very specific in providing very important information to them, but at least the process overall needs to be made aware or made to be made known to them. The other aspect in communication is that to make it very effective, it is very important, or it's advisable basically, to identify a particular person from the management or from the auditee's department to be the coordinator for the audit. That helps basically in discussing issues with them, or in terms of escalating aspects of audit importance or data requests that might have not come. So that gives us a one-point contact and definitely helps in adding value too. So these are certain best practices I thought I can share from the industry's perspective. So over to you, Vijayaraj, on the next one.
Yes. So we're on this SIA 9 about communication. Let's move on to SIA 10 that deals with internal audit evidence. I think all, let it be any court of law, they always talk about, do we have an evidence for what we are speaking on. Just the question of my subjective analysis is not sufficient. We need an evidence for everything. So what is the evidence that I can get from? What I say is not sufficient, but can I corroborate with an evidence? Can I say that, okay, this is what I have with me to prove my point? Just like we say in a regular statutory audit, we need all the audit papers, we need audit notes and things like that. In internal audit also, I think very important aspect is to have an evidence of the audit what we are doing. Evidences, again, we are all aware of, just like we have in statutory audit, we are talking about internal evidences and external evidences. Evidences might have been generated from the auditee and given to the third party, or it can be generated by the third party and received by the auditee. Or any of these evidences is of always any help, it's always of great help for us. Most importantly, it should be persuasive in nature. What do you mean by persuasive evidence? If we have any kind of an evidence, that evidence, once I get one evidence, can I say this is sufficient for me? No, I need to cross check it to see whether there was some other evidence that is required. When we say that, you know, balance sheet has tallied, fine, balance sheet has tallied, but how? We need to understand as to what is the process that was adopted for finding this. All evidences, let me take you through what SIA 10 tells about evidences in audit. Let us go through the slides. Let me start with the first one, internal audit evidence. SIA 10 talks about introduction, audit evidences, categories of documenting evidence, and modes of obtaining audit evidence. Let's look at the first one, that is introduction and objective. Scope and coverage are much broader than statutory audit, because statutory audit has its own limitations, but internal audit is such a continuous process and so much time can be spent on internal audit that we cover much larger area than what a statutory audit would have covered. You should make a comment on internal control systems, risk management, proprietary aspects of transactions. We should also look into qualitative as well as quantitative aspects of evidences in internal audit. The audit evidence, it should be persuasive rather than conclusive in nature. That means, do I have cross checking done? Do I have alternative evidences in this regard? And of course, last but not the least, next we're talking about materiality of the item, the type of information available, and degree of risk of misstatements in whatever evidences has been collected by us. And this is what we invented, the possible evidences. The categories of document evidences could be either originating from and held by a third party himself, or it can be originating from third party and held by the entity, or vice versa. And ultimately, what are the modes of obtaining audit evidence? Let's see the modes of obtaining audit evidence. The way in which we can obtain audit evidence is by inspection, by observation. Observation is a very key area. In fact, we know so many instances wherein in internal audit we have traced a lot of issues. I am sure most of you would have also found out by mere observation itself, you come to know that something seems to be wrong somewhere, something must have gone wrong somewhere, and you are in a position to highlight and say something is wrong and here is what I will get the evidences through observation. The link is from observation, inquiry and confirmation, computation and analytical review. Let us see what Harish has to say on this.
Okay, so the important aspect as far as evidences are concerned is to tie up the evidences to the risks that have been identified. So the level of procedures that have to be performed should be in accordance with the risk that has been identified as part of the risk assessment process at the planning stage. And that risk has to be evaluated continuously during the audit. It is not a one-time exercise and we say, okay, fine, we've identified this risk and we're not going to do anything more to continuously find out whether that information that we obtain at the time of the planning phase is right or wrong. So, but it is a continuous exercise where we try to evaluate on a continuous basis if there are other risks in the process and accordingly add or reduce our audit procedures and the evidences that we collect so that we make our audit effective and meaningful. And one other aspect is you need to trust the auditee. It's not that you are trying to have a suspicion at every second, but it doesn't mean we do not perform our audit procedures. So it's a balance between trusting and the amount of verification that we do. So we need to get our evidences, probably it might be in the form of a signed document from the auditee. So the level of procedures is dependent on the risk inherent in the particular process, and that has been identified at the time of the scoping and planning phase. So over to you, Guru, on the next one.
Thank you. We are almost reaching to the last 4-5 standards, and the last 3 standards are smaller ones. So we would need to move it a little faster, and I am sure we would be able to give a few questions out. Questions are rising from international auditing standards from Raipur to Kanyakumari. We have been getting a whole lot of them. Thank you. SAL 11 deals about consideration of fraud in an internal audit, especially in today's corporate world. If you just go back one decade earlier or 15 years earlier, the corporate world was never as big as this. Today we have global corporations and Indian corporations becoming global. If you take an Indian enterprise, they have operations in 20 countries and 30 countries. There are companies with 1.5 lakh, 2 lakh people. Earlier in those days, 4-5 decades ago, it used to be the public sectors. Today, private sectors are having 40,000 employees and 50,000 employees. The same silk shop at the end of your road is no longer the same silk shop. Even they have a chain of stores. So when the context of economy has changed so drastically and so fast, our country is not geared up so much to gear up to the infrastructure in terms of accounting, in terms of software, in terms of governance reporting, in terms of whistleblowing. So that makes this SIA very, very vital. This is one standard which goes into the impact of this almost goes into the sampling, the impact of this goes into the risk mitigation, the impact of this goes into the internal control aspects. A fraud can go into governance and the fraud can go into the going concern. Just in this decade, you would have seen so many corporates just closed down because the internal audit function never pointed out what had to be actually pointed out. So there is definitely the standard is telling the primary responsibility for prevention and detection of fraud rests with the management. That does not give auditors as a laurels. Auditors have a moral responsibility to find out what is going wrong. We are the guys who are sitting in the third shoe steps. We would need to find out exactly what is happening. It has to be a complementary sort of a thing. We can't just take a cognizance stating that, okay, it's a management job, we should not be able to just do it like that. Just take you to a few slides here. Can you please take us through the slides? Excuse me. Please look at here. So consideration of fraud in an internal audit, what is the objectives of the control systems, what are the elements of a control system, and what is our responsibility as internal auditor? Fraud is defined, and the primary responsibility for prevention and detection of frauds rests with the management. But that does not absolve us from responsibilities. There has been
many cases with the institute stating that, yeah, responsibility rests with the management. But what were the auditors doing at that point of time? Auditors would have to point out this instance. And when you look at the situation of what is the objectives, we would need to see what is the reliability of the financial reporting. It can be a branch reporting, it can be a global MIS reporting, it can be a statutory audit reporting, it can be reporting of the salesman to the sales manager. What is the reliability of this reporting itself? What is the effectiveness of the operations? And what are the compliances with the applicable standards? What are the safeguards of the assets? We should not have a situation where a bank account of a company has just got gone all of a sudden. And what are the elements of an internal control system would make a vital impact in the fraud detection case? As long as the control systems are fabulous, my risk mitigation would be much, much better. If the risk mitigation is favorable to us, the sample size goes down. If the sample size goes down, the audit objectivity increases. As long as there is objectivity which is going up, the bias of the auditor also goes down. So it's a chain link between everything. So the elements of the internal audit control system would be, what is the control environment? What is the entity's risk assessment process? Is there a process at all for finding out the risk? Is there an internal process for finding out what is happening there? And what are the information systems and communication systems happening? And the control activities, and who is monitoring these controls? What is the responsibility of an internal auditor would be? Is there a control environment in this process? What are the control activities? Is there a QC team? Is there job rotation policies? Is there compulsory leave? What is the drop dead policy of the company? What is the disaster recovery mechanism of the company? How is communication of fraud done? How is it documented? We need to go back to the HR records, find out where it has happened, and several of those aspects. So fraud can never be taken lightly. It is one of the most founding principles of internal audit. We can't just keep on going on giving, okay, I found out the following mistakes in cash watching. That is not the end, and it would not absolve us from any of the liabilities. I'm sure Harish would have identified, would be well aware of fraud mitigation policies and how does he actually handle it in the corporate world.
Right. So fraud, I mean, speaking from a corporate world, I mean, we have multinational corporations again, which have its presence in multiple locations across the globe. So it's very difficult for an organization to even know what has happened at every location. But it's very important to have a whistleblowing policy, basically to identify any suspects of fraud. And it's very important to even have a standards of business conduct or any such professional standard that helps all employees or which guides all employees on a professional code of conduct. And that probably forms the basis of identifying fraud or even whistleblowing a particular incident that might happen. And certain areas are definitely prone to more fraud than other areas, basically being revenue. Revenue being one of the most important areas, other being discounts that are provided basically. Then we have inventory, a lot of frauds do happen in inventory valuation. Then you have treasury, you also have certain AP processes, vendor payments, things like that, which are definitely prone to more fraud. So how do we go about evaluating this particular aspect as far as audit is concerned? So this has to happen at the beginning of the audit itself. It cannot happen in between the audit. So at the time of planning the audit, we need to have a discussion with the relevant stakeholders. Probably it may be a fraud auditor. Probably it might be we go and check the databases of fraud in the relevant area and try to see what are the processes that have actually undergone a deficiency in this particular aspect. It might be a conversation with the legal team to understand any contractual fraud or anything of that nature. And also it might be important to do a search from external sources to identify frauds in these areas. So these have to be accordingly considered in the risk in the process, and the audit procedures that are in place have to be sufficient enough to mitigate those risks. And it might be a good suggestion in case a particular area is considered to be high fraud risk areas, probably an anti-money laundering audit, for example, might have high risk aspects. So it might be important to use an expert or a legal person within the team to be even able to add value to the particular area as such. So over to you, Vijayaraja, on the next one.
Yes. SIA 12 deals with internal controls. Now, just like we have SA 610, which talks about statutory auditor relying upon the work of an internal auditor, internal auditor also relies upon the internal controls that is existing. And what is the evaluation that I need to do about the internal control? As an internal auditor, we need to evaluate the internal control systems itself. We need to see whether it is competent enough to take care of all the issues, or what is the risk associated with the kind of controls that is existing in the organization, size of the organization that is there, and what are the limitations of internal controls that we can identify and say that this may not be captured in this. So many times we have seen that as long as the organization is getting protected, it may so happen that internal control may not capture the requirement of protecting the consumer also. We need to look at whether internal controls is holistic enough to take care of all aspects. Let me quickly run through the internal control evaluation through the slides about SIA 12. Let's have a look at internal control evaluations. Internal control evaluation SIA 12 deals with the introduction, factors reflected in it, inherent limitations, role of the auditor, areas to be reviewed, areas of evaluation, control present in a system driven environment, tests of control, communication and disclosure. Starting with the control environment, and first to give you an introduction about it, these we need to establish standards and provide guidance on procedures to be followed by internal auditor, communication of weaknesses in internal control, and of course we need to also see whether we can correlate it such that the risk assessment also is taken care. In the control environment, management's philosophy and operating style. We need to see what is the management philosophy and what is the operating style, what are the integrity and ethical values that is being followed, and what is the competence level up to which they have. Continuing further on this, inherent limitations of internal controls could be cost benefit analysis is a major issue because internal controls comes at a cost. Now can we ensure that the limitations are taken care of? As to what is the, because every management looks into internal control, is it effective or not effective? Then manipulations by management, we need to see whether controls are good enough or is it controlled by the higher management and there is a possibility of misuse of power in this aspect. As far as role of internal auditor is concerned, we need to ensure that we can develop some control which is a self-assessment. We talk about a lot of aspects like shadowing activities, we talk about a lot of aspects about compulsory leave systems, rotation policies, what kind of internal controls are there and what is it that I need to look at in these areas. And ultimately the areas of review for internal audit, there can be various areas we look at. Ultimately we look at the KPIs, what are the key performance indicators which will help me to evaluate as to what should be the way in which I should look at it, and ultimately the business continuity also has to be looked into. Continuing further on that, when you are talking about the evaluation of internal controls, we need to prepare a proper business control worksheet. We should ensure that all the risks are also identified properly, and it should be system driven environment. If it is a system driven environment, how do we evaluate all the entire process? In the system driven environment, the encryption tools that is to be used, we need to look into that. What is the backup and restore feature that is available? Virus protection softwares, whether it is there? What are the passports and the use, you know, the user access for all the networks that is available? Then test of control. The test of controls, if you look at the last part, we are talking about in-close inspection of documents, inquiries and observation, reconciliations and testing of internal controls, more importantly a re-performance to see whether the internal controls are actually working or not working. In the entire reporting scenario, when we have to communicate about the weaknesses, our report must also talk about what are the weaknesses that are existing in the internal controls. Now if we identify some weaknesses are there, you can't change anything about it, but at least we can report and say that okay, I find that these are the weaknesses that are there in internal controls, and therefore communicate those weaknesses to the management. By communicating, what are the steps we are looking at? Mere communication sufficient? No. We need to ensure that the management tries to increase the supervision levels so that the internal control becomes more stronger. Additional controls should to be added, and also to understand, management must accept that yes, there is some risk that is involved. And once we are clear on these terms, then we know to what extent internal audit has to be taken care. If the controls are less, the audit responsibility goes up. If the controls are high, and probably we can rely more on the internal controls. And disclosure, in the report the auditor has to disclose, we need to disclose that what is the management understanding about this, and is there any weaknesses, and what is the significant description of all those weaknesses is there, and ultimately the possible effect of those weaknesses on the industry itself, and what is the effect of those weaknesses in the internal control itself. Let's understand what Harish has to say on this.
Sure. So basically there are certain aspects that I thought I can share with all of you. One being, there might be certain controls in place but the team, the audit team, might have evaluated or might have found out a loophole basically in the process. Now let us say, for example, there is a particular authorization level of say 1 lakh rupees for a particular person. There is a payment for 4 lakhs. We would have all come across this situation in our audit, in our audits. So this payment of 4 lakhs would be broken down into 4 or 5 payments to ensure that the authorization level is available to make or release that payment. So such aspects have to be taken care of and evaluated accordingly while doing our audit. The second aspect that lays a lot of importance basically is on the confidentiality of information. So when you speak of internal controls, it's also important that the management or the organization as a whole identifies what is the different levels of confidentiality a particular information can have. So they need to classify different information in different levels of confidentiality. For example, very critical financial information, especially if it's a listed company. So then certain financial information can never be made available to everyone. There has to be a very stringent process by which only the selected people have access to that information. So even this control plays a very important role in the entire process. The third aspect that I thought I'll speak about is reliance on other service providers within the organization. So there may be a lot of other teams within the organization that also have an oversight on the controls per se. So one might be the other assurance providers, which I did speak about earlier. The second might be the SOX team. The SOX team also performs a lot of testing on the segregation of duties and different controls that are in place. The third one being the ISO audits. So there might be ISO audits that are there, which the auditors might also have reviewed certain processes, and those have to be considered in the audit program, and accordingly we have to scope in the relevant areas. I mean, there's no point of duplicating efforts and causing audit stress to the auditee. And the last one that I thought I'll speak of is the Six Sigma. Basically, Lean Six Sigma helps in identifying, streamlining processes and bringing efficiency into the process and simplifying the process. So these are the aspects that are very important and have to be considered at the time of doing audits. So over to you, Guru, on the next one.
Thanks, gentlemen. We are in SAA 13. What I would do is SAA 13, 14 is an ocean by itself. SAA 13 talks of the enterprise risk management, and SAA 14 talks of the internal audit from an information technology point of view. We would try to brush it as fast as possible, and I would reserve Harish's comment on this later so that we can pick up few of the comments. So SAA 13, I'll just cover it up ASAP and then jump to SAA 14, then we will break at SAA 15 and 16, 17 at one shot. As far as SAA 13 is concerned, enterprise risk management is one of the largest components of internal audit today. Irrespective of the size of the organization, SAA 13 is very vital. We can't just tell it's a small organization, I would not do a risk mitigation or this. We can't even call it as a risk mitigation, we can call it as a risk management. So what would be important is SAA 13 would be very vital from this aspect of it. I would just take you through the slides for SAA 13, and after that we would go there. What is the process of ERM in internal audit? What is the process, what is the scope of an internal audit? What is the maturity of ERM structure, and what would be the disclosure is important. An ERM enables the management to effectively deal with the risk. So you already know that there is a risk. How do you manage the risk, how do you mitigate the risk is important. In case we know that there is no risk, ERM would not apply at all. The fact that in a dynamic business environment, there is a risk for misstatement intentionally or unintentionally. When you look at ERM, it does not mean that okay, somebody is going to come and commit a thieving in our organization. That is not the issue at all. The issue can be totally, you can look at it from a totally different tangent altogether. So is there an uncertainty associated? So if there is an uncertainty associated, how do we enhance the capacity to build the value of the entity? There could be strategic risks, there could be operational risks, there could be financial risks, there could be knowledge risks. It can almost lead from a ERM to, if the ERM, if you don't find out the actual fact in the ERM, it can also go into a sustainability reporting for an enterprise. So ERM is extremely vital from that perspective. The enterprise risk management is a structured, it is not just a discussion parameter where we sit down and discuss what are the risks. There is a structure of internal evidences, there is a structure of external evidences, there are enough of data tools available, past data is available. And it is a consistent process, and it has to be continuously measured in order to assess the risk and develop the strategies to manage risk within the risk appetite. Now, if a company tells, okay, I don't mind having a variation of 2% in my stock management tool, ignore about it, let's ignore it. We are not even concerned on that. process consists of risk identification, very, very vital. If we miss the risk identification, we miss everything. Then we prioritize IT. After we prioritize, we go back to the reporting, and the reporting will take us to the risk mitigation and what do we do for monitoring and assurances. And as an internal auditor, we need to know what is the risk maturity level. We would need to assess whether the scores of residual risk is within the risk appetite of the company. Suppose we identify 5 areas of risk and the management, and we jointly feel that out of these 5 areas of risk, one is something we can look at. It's not a major risk. It can be covered at a lower sampling level. It can be covered at analytical tool level. It cannot be a risk. So we identify the risk as high risk areas, mid risk areas, and low risk areas. Can we go to the next slide, please? Next one, please. And we need to have assurance in the reporting standard as to what would be the assurance rating, whether it can be a high critical area, medium area, or a low area. The management needs to be aware as what is our risk strategy for the company. If I don't tell the management that this is the risk we have perceived, we will be hitting at the dark hat. We would not even know what we are covering, and the management is thinking they are covering something else. I would hand over to Vijay Raja to take the SAA 14.
Well, let us quickly run through SAA 14 with the slide itself. Let's look at SAA 14 itself as it is. It talks about information technology environment. Now, it is in continuation of the ERM, but we have already discussed on SAA 13 that you got 14 also. If we're talking about matters to be considered, the planning process, nature of risk, reliability of the internal control systems, review of the IT environment itself. Now, in the entire process, what are we trying to see? In because today, I think everything is based on IT today. Most of the business entities today work on information technology. By use of information technology, we need to understand the flow of authorization, correct and complete data at the processing center. Now, it's not an easy job for us to find out, but we need to put in efforts to understand as to how the system works. We need to understand what are the internal software mechanisms that is used for controlling and ensuring if it's a computer-based accounting system. What can be the audit trail that I can find out? If I can understand the audit trail, it will help me to understand how I can plan the audit. In planning, we are talking about the complexity of the computerized process. We need to understand how much of availability of data is there. You know, especially in an SAP environment, on an Oracle environment, we need to understand what amount of information we can derive or what is the trail that we can understand from that. The nature of risk involved in this area would be the lack of the trials itself. I have been repeatedly telling you this. The lack of segregation of functions, potential for errors and irregularities that is involved, and also the potential for increased management supervision. So, in when talking about management supervision here, every audit process and every computerized environment will have who has got the authority to make some changes. Who has got the authority at what levels? At different levels, there are different authorization processes. We need to look at what level, who has the authorization process to have the cutoff dates and to change the entries and so on. And what is the reliability I can have on the internal control systems? This can be linked with the previous accounting standards itself, which we talked about internal controls. Regarding review of the IT environment, we need to see, is there any system audit reports? That we will understand as to whether the system is working good or are there any breaches in the system. And if there are breaches in the system, automatically the internal auditor's role will start increasing and there will be more less reliance you can place on what is given in the internal audit systems. Application controls we need to look at, and business continuity and planning, and also all the procedures that is involved. Recovery procedures are very important. If it is IT driven, if something happens to the data, if there is a data crash, how do you recover the entire data is very important for us to understand. And that time we talked about SIA 14 relating to review of IT environment.
Harish, would you be able to just sum up SIA 13 and 14, because these two are fairly important standards?
Sure. So basically on the enterprise risk management, that's a very important aspect in a particular organization. Basically the enterprise risk management team identifies different risks, be it strategic risk, operational risk, financial risk, and reputational risk, nevertheless the most important of all. So what they do is basically the audit, when we try to identify the risk management from an enterprise perspective, we need to look at different aspects such as critical suppliers, critical clients. It might be in the form of, say, a BCP, a business continuity planning. That might be very important, because if there's a problem, there has to be a continuation of business. There might be a disaster recovery planning. So then there are certain other aspects too, such as resiliency. So when there is a shock in the organization, how does the organization react and come up from that particular aspect? And nevertheless, the most important aspect being competitor, how does it behavior basically? The competitor behavior, how do the competitors behave and what is the impact it has on our particular organization? It might even go to a point where we price our products, how we bring our products to the organization, I mean to the world. So everything has an impact, say the image that the organization tries to portray to the world. So all these things have a risk and those have to be monitored, and internal audit does play an important role to ensure that all these factors are considered. The second important aspect is identification of these relevant risks and then basically trying to put them in a particular form, basically the risk response plan, and monitoring them on a continuous basis by a very top management, probably even the board. So they need to come up with a framework by which they identify these risks, might be by discussions with different business units, might be with discussion with different stakeholders, external stakeholders, internal stakeholders, statutory auditors, internal audit. So all these factors play an important role in identifying what are the risks and monitoring them on a continuous basis. The role of internal audit is identifying what are the procedures followed by the enterprise risk management team and how well are they faring in terms of identifying the risks in advance and then having a proper plan in place to even mitigate these risks. The next one on SIA 14 is basically on the IT part, the IT environment. All of us have a lot of apprehension on this particular aspect, but to quickly sum up certain relevant aspects of this standard, the importance of IT environment in today's world is so huge. A lot of companies have lot of standard processes basically from the IT perspective, and lot of companies have non-standard processes as well. So some companies have a mix of both, some companies have sort of standardized most of these processes and integrated them. So when we look at a particular environment where there is a mix of both standard and non-standard, basically system and non-systemic environment, the risk is bound to be more because there is a lot of reliance on non-standard processes, or probably I wouldn't even say non-standard processes, non-system driven processes. So in those cases, we need to be very careful in identifying the controls in place. Probably there might be a Microsoft Excel file that is maintained for most of the things. Probably an MIS might be on Microsoft Excel, might be reporting might be on Microsoft Excel, adjustments might be on Microsoft Excel. So all these things add up to the risk in the organization, and there might be so many calculations, evaluations done on Microsoft Excel or any other tool for that matter, and all those things might have not been reflected in the systemic environment. So when we run different reports, the impact of these exceptions would have a big impact in terms of our decision making as such. So the auditor has two sort of procedures, one being IT general controls and other being application controls. So general controls are more like access driven, physical access or even logical access, like access to the system, be it passwords, be it hacking the system. So all these things have to be considered by that organization, by the auditor as well in evaluating the particular system. The second aspect being the BCP, the business continuity planning. Let us say if there is a theft of the system itself, a physical theft. So is there a data backup? So that's the first question, how frequently do we backup? Things like that play a very important role. Then the third aspect is change management. So how effective are we in managing change? Change here basically means an updation of the system, evaluating the system and trying to bring in new efficiencies into the system. So all these factors have to be brought in, and there should be a particular development development environment where all these changes happen, then it has to be tested and then only brought into the production environment. And then the last one is on the application controls, where we test the system logic itself. So that's very important because if say for example a depreciation calculation, how does the system perform? So what is its implication from the income tax perspective? Then we might have very complex things that the system perform. For example, on the e-commerce side now, we have a lot of online transactions that are going on. So how does the system evaluate whether a particular transaction or particular order that comes on the e-commerce site is fraudulent or not? So there's a particular logic built into the system, and the auditor is bound to evaluate the logic as such and then accordingly find the riskiness in the system and report thereon. So these are the factors I basically had on these two standards. We can move on probably to the next aspect of it.
Thanks, Harish. I will rush through 16 and 17. Could you mind putting the camera this side, please? I would not look at the slides. The slides are pretty large. I'll run through the 16 and as fast as possible, the 15th one and the 16th one. As far as the 15th is concerned, we are talking of the environment of the entity. We would need to understand the environment both from external sources, industry sources, continuous upgradation of knowledge, keeping in touch with the economy, keeping in touch with the industry. So generally it would mean that you need to know what you are auditing. If you are going to audit a jewelry shop, you would need to know what is the jewelry market before going in there. If you are going in to do the food industry, you need to know what is the FDA regulations in US to go there. So you need to be aware of what are the external entity environments as far as SIS 16 is concerned. Now coming into SIS 16, it is a use of the work of an expert. Internal audit is a factor where you have to have in a large enterprise. Not just a chartered accountant, we may need to have a cost accountant, we may need to have a civil engineer for a manufacturing construction company. If I am doing an audit of a drug discovery company, I would rather like to have a biotechnologist in my team. If I am doing the audit of a software company, I would need to have a software professional in my team. So it would be a culmination of varied professionals. But how do I rely on the work of an expert? Suppose I am doing a work of a railway locomotive industry. I don't know anything about railway locomotive industry as a chartered accountant except my specialist finance knowledge. Who would give me knowledge about this? If you are talking of a telecommunication industry, I would need to have a telecommunication scientist. How does the entire software act? It is almost like a black box. So these two standards are very vital from the perspective of getting external support for doing an internal audit. Otherwise, most times as a chartered accountant who is a finance specialist or who is a commercial specialist, I would be hitting against the dark. I'll hand it over to Raja for SIS
17. SIS 17 deals with laws and regulations. And when it comes to SIS 17, I think this is something which all of us have been taking care of. As auditors, we've always been stressing on the issue of what are the laws and what are the regulations that are available. We always have been looking at doing an audit whether there is legal compliance, whether all laws have been complied or not. But what are the limitations that we have in doing an internal audit? I don't think any of us can proudly say that we are aware of absolutely all the laws in the country. I don't know how many thousands of laws that we must be having, whether we have a knowledge about all possible laws in this country. Whether I know that if a person walks into, in fact I was told by somebody that when a person walks into a restaurant and the restaurant guy does not offer water, it may be some kind of a violation of some law in some act. We don't even know whether what laws are being violated in which phase. Now we may not be aware about all the laws, but given the limitations, to the extent of what we are aware, whether we can ensure that we can take care of all the laws and regulations, at least report to the fact that these are the laws that we have looked into or what are the limitations which are there in covering up all the laws. I would like to add on this particular point, Guru.
Especially from the legal perspective, as an internal auditor, we need to look at a sustainability reporting. I will explain a case to you. Suppose I would not know when this happened. In Rajasthan, there was a pulpit manufacturing company. As an internal auditor, I would need to know that the Rajasthan government is going to ban all these things. So the business continuity itself is lost. So I need to be aware of what are the laws and what are the provisions which are going there. We have around 4 minutes left as per my watch. We would like to take a few questions. The whole perspective of this is to give you an idea about SIA 1 to SIA 17. By the type of questions we are getting, by the type of mails we are getting from the time we started it, we have got an excess of around 130 mails. It's been a good thing by from your side. Thank you so much. Just to take a few questions, Mr. VK is asking, is it mandatory? No, it is not mandatory. It is not a law. But my friend, please note that make it mandatory for yourself. It's good for you. Even though the institute tells it is not mandatory, it's a fabulous standard. Make it mandatory as a moral principle. Mr. Rajavanshi is telling, is internal audit a support to the stat audit? Definitely yes. Internal audit would be a substantial support to the stat audit. There is a guidance note to this effect. Please refer to the guidance note. I am not aware of the number right now. We would communicate back to you. Mr. Jatin tells, how are the prospects of SIA globally? Globally, Indian prospects are fantastic. We are there from everywhere, from Budapest to Czechoslovakia to Bahrain to Oman. And chartered accountants are going everywhere. And Indian economy is going everywhere. We are going places. When we are going places, money will go places. When money will go places, ICA will go places and SIA will follow through. SIA would be very, very important of it. Got a question from Balaji of Muscat. Balaji of Muscat. Can an internal auditor use a voice recorder through mobile example during the audit process and use it as an audit documentation? The SIA is quite silent on that aspect. I would definitely write to the Internal Audit Standards Board to bring out this. But from an audit parlance, yes, it can act as an audit evidence, but it is very important for an internal auditor to tell the auditee, I am using this as a recording device, can I use it? Especially when you go for risk assessments, when you go for evaluation techniques, when you go for determining the samples, when you are going for laws and regulation standards or work of an expert, it may be very important to have a recording device. We have done it, but made it very clear to the auditee, yes, I am doing this, it cannot be done discreetly. That would be wrong on the professional aspect of it. Mr. Mehta writes down, how is SA 610 and 315 getting impacted? SA 315 must be the matter relating to material misstatements, so I am not having enough of material with me right now. SA 610 would mean that reliance of the auditor, it has to be read in tandem. SA 610 and 315, when the person is relying on the 610, he would need to also consider whether there are any misstatements. So both go hand in hand either way. Very interesting question from Mr. Rajender. Internal auditor is appointed by the management. How can we communicate on fraud and inefficiencies to the management? Many a time there is an ego issue. What is the best way to communicate audit observation directly to the management? Sir, the best way is to tell the truth, but truth has to be told diplomatically. Truth hurts, but if I don't tell the truth, I would be doing disregarding to my profession. There are audit SIS standards for communication. Diploma is very, very vital in this aspect. We have to make it important also. You can't just make a passing reference, yes, there was a small fraud committing for financial statement. You can't just make a passing reference. It has to be regarded as a high risk item. It has to be shown as a high risk item. We have to diplomatically tell, and there is nothing wrong in telling a fraud is a fraud. It is our moral responsibility, it is our professional duty to do so. Whether internal auditor, this has come from Ghanshyam Joshi, I think we have a couple of minutes. Whether the internal auditor can be one of the check signing authorities, impossible. We cannot be a check signing authorities. I am not sure of which guidance note subjects to this, but there would be a bias when we start doing this. Yes, as a part of the concurrent audit process, yes, we can. We are also involved in the pass of passing bills. We are also involved in the pass of pricing checks. But definitely not as an internal auditor, it would affect our bias. I am sorry, there are few more questions, but the clock has hit 6. It has been a pleasure bringing SAA to you. I thank IASB for giving us this opportunity. I thank our team, Vijay Raja, Chartered Accountant, and Harish Moti from Chartered Accountant from HP Global Internal Audit. Thank you very much, friends. It was great speaking to you. Have a good day and a wonderful life ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, friends.